Knicks' delicate chemistry was one of the keys to their success, but that fine balance would soon have to be altered. In 1971, their bid to repeat as champions was cut short by the Bullets in the conference finals. Willis had been hobbled by injuries throughout the series, and the Knicks, no longer a young team, suffered from a lack of depth. Changes would have to be made. To back up Willis, Jerry Lucas was acquired in exchange for Cassie Russell. And in one of the franchise's most dramatic moves, basketball's greatest one-on-one performer, Earl the Pearl Monroe, was brought to New York. On paper, the Knicks had solved their problems, but the question remained whether their team harmony would survive.
The New York press was saying that there was no way the two of us could play in the same backcourt. We would need two basketballs.
But the problems that the media predicted never materialized.
I just changed my style to try and fit in with the guys to let them know that I wasn't coming in and taking anybody's stardom or anything, that I wanted to be a part of the team.
With Monroe and Lucas both eagerly adopting the team's unselfish ideal, the Knicks made it back to the finals. With Willis hurt again, they would lose to the Lakers, but they had proven that their special chemistry was still intact. And as the 72-73 season began, the feeling of storybook magic was once again in the air. On November 18, 1972, the Bucks would become early believers. Leading 86-78, with under 6 minutes remaining, they felt that victory was assured. But their 86th point would be their last, and no one was leaving the Garden early.
Frazier goes to the baseline. He turns the fadeaway. It's short. Rebound, Jabbar. No good. Gives to the Busher, long jump. Yes! 25-footer by the Busher. Pick up by Bradley, fast break. Gives to Monroe on the right. He pulls up. Here's the jump. Yes! 86-83! Titles on the line. He can move it within one. It is down to one. So Allen will go to the line. He is a very good foul shooter. 91%. The first under. He missed a clutch free throw. Now the second. It is up. No good! To the foul line, fakes, hands to Monroe, side jump, yes, the next three-point run, fires from the basket to Jabbar, he turns, it's short, and the Knicks have stolen the ball game.
You got a feeling at that time that, well, we're destined to do it again or something. when we ran off those 19 straight points, you really felt that you couldn't be stopped.
The 73 Knicks would find new ways to win. They would rely more on their bench, as Dean Memminger created turnovers and sparked their running game. Phil Jackson used his long arms to create havoc on defense. And the versatile Jerry Lucas provided long-range shooting. And heady play in the pivot. And as Frazier and Monroe meshed at guard, they dominated opposing backcourts. Though he had toned down his one-on-one show, the Pearl had lost none of his luster.
There's never been two players together that were that good in the same backcourt as those two guys. They were the best ever.
With the new players all contributing, the Knick veterans were rested and ready for the playoffs. Willis was finally healthy, and the aging Knicks knew that this title run could be their last. The Pearl began the Knicks' playoff march in style, leading them past the Bullets in five games. But the conference finals would prove to be a more difficult obstacle. And the Knicks would need heroic efforts from everyone if they were to get by the favored Celtics.
I was the kind of player that would challenge for the ball all the time. I was a person that didn't play defense defensively.
Play tight by Jackson. Cross court White. White has the ball stolen by Jackson!
In game four, Phil Jackson's hustle helped the Knicks pull out a pivotal double overtime victory and take a commanding series lead.
You must understand, we were up 3-1 against Boston. And they were able to pull out games 5 and game 6. No one had ever beaten Boston in the seventh game in the Boston Garden.
It was a piece of Celtic history that the Knicks would now rewrite. Memminger would come off the bench like a whirlwind to ignite the Knicks. And with Clyde pushing the offense into high gear, New York convincingly defeated Boston on its home floor, dealing a painful blow to the Celtic playoff mystique. A second title was almost within reach. As they had in their first championship season, New York would face LA in the finals. But this year's confrontation would have none of the drama of the initial one, as the Knicks would crush the Lakers in five games. This series would be a celebration of recaptured glory and a tribute to enduring determination. For Monroe and Lucas, this was the championship that had eluded them throughout their careers. While for the veterans of the 1970 team, it was the title that would assure their rightful place in history. Steadfastly holding to their team philosophy, they had preserved their unique chemistry and left an indelible mark on their era.
The New York Knicks have defeated the Los Angeles Lakers by the score of 102-93, and they race off the court here at the Forum of Los Angeles with the 1973 World Championship.
I think the second victory etched in our minds, at least mine, that, you know, we were a team for a period. We weren't a flash in the pan.
And here you had a bunch of guys from all diverse backgrounds come together and to form this unit that will be remembered forever. I thought that team should be remembered for those three, 4 years, 5 years, is whatever. It's probably the smartest basketball team ever assembled.